It's not my brother.
It's not my brother, no, my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's not my brother, no, my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
Thank you so much, Donna. That was wonderful. Welcome. Believe it or not, it is September. We are getting to Christmas, believe it. And I have some friends who have already started to count down to Christmas, and I'm like, are you kidding me? Let me enjoy fall, for heaven's sake. So, welcome to everyone who has gathered with us for worship today, the first Sunday of September. And next week, we have what we call Back to Church Sunday. Once upon a time, we called it Rally Sunday. So next week, Sunday, we are inviting everyone to join in. If you know people who haven't been here in a while and they have not visited, next week, Sunday is a good Sunday to rally them to come out. And we have we've sent out invitations for that Sunday and for our concert on the 30th of September to 2,500 homes. So some of you might get a little invitation in your mailbox throughout the course of this week that says, come to Back to Church Sunday, and also consider keeping it and coming to our concert on the 30th. So look out for that. But just remember, if each of us bring one person next week, I think we would have a decently full house. So remember, next week is Back to Church Sunday, and we want to have a good time as we prepare for the new season that is ahead of us. Also this week, we'll be offering the community, at least the school community, coffee. So coffee will be on us Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. We'll be out front handing out coffee to the community, the people particularly going and bringing the children to school. And it will be an opportunity for the kids to get what we call a backpack blessing. So I will be there, and Betty will be there. And we're hoping to have that opportunity just to connect with the children and the parents and the teachers as they head back to Sharon's school this time around. So welcome to everyone. And I wanted to celebrate with those having birthdays in the month of September. This is me giving you permission to call them. So Kathy Sweezy is having her birthday this month. Ed is having his birthday. So is Bob and Peter Starmo and Zahir. And if my dad were alive, he would also be having his birthday on the 9th of September. So I want to give you a special blessing to the September born this month. I bless the day that you were born. It was a good day. And know without a shadow of a doubt that the world is better for having you in it. And then we have some veteran married people among us, because Glenn and Irene Langford are celebrating 68 years of marriage. And today is that day. So I'm giving you permission to greet Glenn and call Irene and wish them a happy, happy anniversary. And Glenn, I bless the day of your union. I'm sure you believe it was a good day. And know that your love and patience towards each other is a witness to all of us that marriage can work. All right. So welcome everyone, and please feel free to dance and sing and clap as you feel moved this morning as we worship. Let us stand for the call to worship. Joy comes to those who follow the ways of the Lord.
We will follow the Lord with joyful hearts.
Those who follow the Lord are like trees planted by the river, bearing fruit each season.
May our lives be fruitful and blessed by God.
Worship the Lord who leads us to joy and abundance.
Let us worship God now and for all our days.
Let us acknowledge the land together. For thousands of years, First Nations people have walked on this land. Their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives and spirituality. Today, we are gathered on the traditional territory of the Anishinaabe, Haudenosaunee, and Wendat nations, and we acknowledge their stewardship of that throughout the ages. We seek to live in respect, peace, and right relations with them as we live, work, and worship upon their traditional territory. We are also mindful of broken covenants and the need to strive to make right with all our relations. Let us sing our gathering hymn 87, I Am the Light of the World.
Thank you.
be seated as we continue worship with prayer. Let us pray. God of all creation, you have opened the world around us and filled it with creatures of your love and purpose. Each one declares your praise. The mountain states your majesty, the ripened fields your generosity. Birds flying aloft sing of your freedom, the tiny ant works with your persistence. And what do we declare about you in our lives?
We pray that our work will honor your justice and mercy. May our relationships speak of your love and compassion. So may we praise you, O God, not just in this hour of worship, but in all our waking and our working. Challenge us today to live out the praise we offer you through the grace of Jesus Christ and the guidance of the Holy Spirit.
God of justice and mercy, we offer you our love and loyalty in worship. Yet we admit we do not live out that love and loyalty consistently.
We don't always act on our good intentions. We assume the worst in others and treat them accordingly. We don't always keep our promises. We hurt each other with malice and gossip, and then refuse to seek or offer forgiveness. People looking at us must sometimes wonder if what we do or say is what means to follow Jesus. O Lord, you have searched us and know us through and through. Forgive us. Transform our stubborn hearts and wayward wills so that we will live as your Spirit directs us and reflect your goodness in word, thought, and deed. Amen.
Here are the words of assurance. From now on, St. Paul declared, we regard no one from a human point of view. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away, and see, everything has become new. Thanks be to God that we can make a new start this very day. Amen. Our song of response, Voices United 958. Halle, halle. Hallelujah. Going to greet our neighbors to our right or left and behind us and beside us with a high five. You're going to put an ear high five and greet your neighbor. This morning, the peace of the Lord be with you. Our seed of faith for today.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Seeds of Faith. I am Reverend Siddiqui. Do you know how to whistle? Me? Not really. But if you wanted to learn how to whistle, what would you do? How about playing a guitar? How about doing a handstand One hand, two. Can you prepare your favorite snack? The seed for today is becoming good at something. What would have to happen for you to learn that skill you want to be good at? Well, first, someone would have to show you how to do it properly, and then you'd have to practice to get it right. True? But did you notice that one of the things about learning is that the time we choose to spend learning about that thing is time that we do not spend on other things? So if we really want to be good at something, then we are going to spend a lot of time learning and practicing that one thing, right? Which also means that we are going to have less time for other things, even things that we like and enjoy, like hanging out with friends or playing games. In today's scripture story in Luke chapter 14, 25 to 33, we hear that Jesus is surrounded by crowds of people. This wasn't unusual. These crowds followed Jesus often, but not in the way that the disciples did. The same disciples were always following Jesus, copying what he did and listening closely to what he said. The people in the crowds, though, only followed Jesus when he was nearby and when they had nothing else to do. Which is why, in today's scripture story, Jesus is telling the people in the crowd that if they really want to learn the skills that he, Jesus, knows, then they're going to have to put a lot more time into learning and practicing what Jesus is teaching them. In other words, Jesus was telling the crowds that they can't just be a disciple sometimes or whenever they feel like it. Instead, being a disciple is something that they would have to put lots of thought and effort into practicing. Being a disciple takes effort, careful consideration, and practice. So here is the seed for this week. As followers of Jesus, we learn to be disciples from Jesus's teaching. We become good at being disciples by taking the time to learn and put into practice Jesus's teachings. Sometimes becoming a disciple may require us having to give up something in order to make space for the good we want to do in Christ. Other times, it takes a lot of effort and time. But remember, it's always worth it in the end. Don't forget this week, practice makes perfect, but perfection comes with a cost. See you next week. Bye.
As we prepare to hear the reading of scripture, we will sing Voices United 506, Take My Life and Let It Be.
Sunday, I did not know what the readings were. And I was so pleased to see that the Old Testament reading is Psalm 139, which just happens to be my favorite psalm. And I'm reading verses 1 to 6 and 13 to 18. O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely, O Lord. You hem me in behind and before. You have laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. And the gospel reading is Luke. Sorry, I'm having trouble with the fine print in my Bible. Chapter 14, verses 25 to 33. The cost of being a disciple. Large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. May God bless us to understand these words from Scripture.
Let us stand and sing the song Before the Reflection, Voices United 562, Jesus Calls Us.
Thank you.
Let us pray. You may be seated. God of truth and wisdom, send us your Holy Spirit as we listen to your word. Refresh our understanding and equip us to respond to you in love. For the sake of Christ our Lord. Amen. Life insurance is something that people add to their financial plan if they're interested in providing a measure of security for their loved ones. And each case is different, but for most people, they take out life insurance to ensure that their family is financially secure and can continue to maintain their standard of living after a loss or death. In return for paying the premiums, the insurance company will pay out the agreed amount. Premiums are normally paid to the life insurance company on either a monthly or an annual basis for a fixed period of time, and in some cases, until the death eventually occurs. The cost of these plans vary according to our personal circumstances, such as our age or previous medical history and the amount of coverage we want. The Christian life insurance is a measure of security that God put in place for us, paid out upon Christ's death, and to which we are the beneficiaries. And though we are not required to pay a premium for the insurance in itself, as Jesus already did that, he is seeking to teach his followers that as beneficiaries, there are acceptance costs, that discipleship carries a premium. Jesus demands commitment. He never tries to disguise the cost of discipleship. Instead, he writes the price tag large for everyone to see. But Jesus doesn't require anything of his disciples that he is not himself willing to give. Jesus opens this teaching with some strong words. If anyone comes to me and doesn't hate his own mother or father, wife, children, brothers and sisters, yet his own life also, they cannot be my disciple. And this is a difficult verse to hear because it sounds very anti-family, as hating anyone would be a violation of second part of the great commandment to love your neighbor as yourself. And hating one's parent would be a violation of the fifth commandment, honor your father and mother that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord has given you. The word hate that Jesus uses here is an exaggeration for effect. But Jesus would never tell us to break a commandment. Jesus is trying to help people to understand that to follow him is a serious and significant commitment, as serious as it would be to hate your parents or your children or your spouse or yourself. Dare I say, Jesus is laying out the challenge that to follow him requires that we love God more than anything and anyone else. Being a Christian is not a casual activity. It requires deliberate, committed focus and loyalty, even in times of difficulty. Everyone who follows must be prepared to do some cross-bearing, to make some sacrifices, a sacrifice of self, a sacrifice of time, a sacrifice of personal resources for the sake of building the kingdom and in the interest of helping others. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, in his exposition of this text, spells out what he believes to be what is required to follow Christ. And he talks about the concept of cheap grace. Cheap grace is preaching of forgiveness without requiring repentance. It is baptism without discipline. It is communion without confession. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship, grace without the cross, grace without Christ, living and incarnate. Costly grace confronts us as a gracious call to follow Jesus. It comes as a word of forgiveness to the broken spirit and contrite heart, but it compels us to submit to Christ and follow him. What does it mean to submit? To submit is to abide by God's word, to follow it, and to conform our will and our thoughts to it. To submit is to accept that all that comes with following Christ, the good and the bad. To submit is to allow the Holy Spirit to direct and correct and empower us to becoming who Christ would like us to be. To submit is to surrender. All to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily. I surrender all. I surrender. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all. And when we say we surrender, when we say we submit, it is giving over our sense of self, our sense of understanding, our sense of right and wrong, and taking on Jesus' way. In the process of doing that, we become like Christ. And that is Jesus' goal. So as far as Jesus is concerned, if you're going to follow me, prepare to change. Jesus accepts whatever we're willing to give at the moment as a sort of entry-level discipleship. That is why there is no criteria to following Christ. You can come as you are. And that's what I like us to think this morning. So many of us are not ready to lay down our life for the gospel. And when we sing a song like I Surrender All, the all is in quotes because it's all except for many of us. Just enough, but not quite everything. Many of us are not there yet to fork out all our earthly possessions. But what part of your life are you willing to commit? How much are you willing to give to Christ and Christ alone? Maybe not all, because maybe we're not all there yet. But how much? And has there been a change in how much you've given from the day you started this journey? And Jesus is saying there should be. If you started out giving 5% of your life by showing up on Easter and Christmas, where are you now? Every Sunday? At least 2 Sundays? How much change has happened over time? And as far as Jesus is concerned, there should be a gradual change in how much we give until we get to all. To be honest, we all fall somewhere on the scale. but that all of us should be willing to start somewhere. Truth is, most of us will never be called to face a firing squad, although there are still places in this world where there are people who are called to stand and choose the gallows between the gallows and their lives as Christians. We'll be tested in smaller ways. But the good news is, every time we choose Christ over the things of this world, a part of our old nature will die, and a little part of Christ's new creation is born in us. Every time we choose to forgive, every time we have a conversation with someone and at the end of it we realize, I should not have said that, and we go back and apologize, every time we do that, a little more of our old self dies and more of us becomes converted into Christ's likeness. That's how I understand Christian discipleship, that we grow in grace and the love of God little by little. But rest assured, friends, there is a standard. We are supposed to turn into something else, a better version of who we are. A better Vicky, if there is such a thing. A better Brenda. A better Keith. A better Ron. A better Audrey. A better Kathy. A better you. That is what that psalm is about. That when God designed us, God had a vision for who we are, but God also gave us a will. And unfortunately, our wills always clash with God's great design. And yet, knowing us, Jesus' sacrifice serves to give us that head start to make the changes that we should. So Jesus demands total allegiance, to love him above family and friends and property and even life itself. That is the goal. And the more we entrust ourselves, the more we experience the fullness of God's grace, we are one step ahead. The discipleship premium is change. It changes us. And our challenge is a willingness to surrender. Change that is sometimes painful and costly, but worth it. So are you willing to change, to collect on this insurance? This is a discipleship premium. Put God first above all and surrender to following Christ's principles, whatever the cost. And are we willing and ready to pay it? Amen. On this Labor Day weekend, we offer to God the fruit of our labor in support, to support in the redeeming work that God has begun in the world. Give in hope and in trust that God will accomplish more than we can ask or imagine through the gifts we gather. We sing Voices United 510. We have this ministry as the ushers receive the offerings today. Let us bless the offering together.
O God, we offer these gifts to you. Bless them and use them to heal and reshape the world you love with the good news we celebrate in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. As we prepare to offer prayers for our community, for each other, we will sing Voices United 642. Be thou my vision.
Thank you.
talent with which you bless your people.
Have accomplished through the work we do, and for what each one of us contributes to the well-being of our community. Inspire us to work together on the challenges we face and surprise us with the solutions to problems that once seemed overwhelming. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Today we pray for all those who labor in difficult situations.
For people who work in terrible conditions and are paid very little. For migrant workers who must labor far away from their families. And for all those who are underpaid or unjustly treated in their workplace. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For those who cannot labor.
For those who are unemployed or underemployed. For those who have become injured on the job or too sick to keep working. For those who are denied the opportunity to earn a living because of war or discrimination. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
We pray for those who labor in our community.
For those who must work today and tomorrow instead of enjoying this long weekend. For those who must work several jobs to care for their families. For those who work at jobs we wouldn't do ourselves because they are messy or unpleasant. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
On this Labor Day, O God, we offer gratitude for laws that protect children, for health and safety practices that prevent tragedies in the workplace, and for generations before us who advocated for vulnerable employees, fair wages, and equal opportunities.
We pray for those looking forward to a new beginning this coming fall, those starting at a new school, or in a new college or university program, those beginning new work or new activities, those settling into a new home and neighborhood, those welcoming new members into the family through birth, adoption, or marriage, and those reuniting with family members.
In this moment of silence, we lift up those on our minds today. We hold Carolyn Gregg in prayer at the sudden passing of Jim. We pray for the family, and we ask for your grace and your love to surround them in this time of grief and loss. May Jim's soul rest in peace, and light perpetual shine on him. Thank you, God, for the work that goes on behind the scenes, delivering things we enjoy and services we rely on. Help us to look beyond these things, to picture the faces of those whose work provides for all our needs. Through their faces, let us see your face, creator and sustainer of all that is.
We pray for our congregation and for a time of reorganizing, rebuilding, and renewal. We pray for a revival. Gather us into new and renewed friendships. We give thanks to God for tasks completed with pride, for work to do, and for the strength and ability to do it. And we pray for those who do not have enough work, and for those who have too much. Show us how to reach out with your love and generosity. Equip us to meet every challenge we face with faithfulness and commitment. We ask this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us stand and sing our closing hymn. More voices, 2, 1, 3. Take up his song. Receive the blessing as we leave this place. We know wherever we go,
God will be with us.
At work or play, at home, as we travel, we know
Christ will be with us.
Whether we are happy or sad, on our own or with friends, we know
the Holy Spirit will be with us.
Wherever we go, whatever we do or say, let us be a good reflection of the Christ we follow. Let us go with joy, because we are not alone. Thanks be to God. Our song for choral parting, Voices United 298, When You Walk From Here. Have a good week, everyone. Lord.